mountains in the east. Mist coming in, like something is brewing, about to begin. Can't put my finger on what lies in store, but I feel what's to happen, or happened before.
Singing with mommy. I don't care how you get here, just get here if you can. Yeah. That's your song.
This is my song. Just a minute. It's called Pretty Bird. First, I have to warm up my vocal cords. Jordan! No, just kidding. Anyway.
And I'm pretty birdie without no wings, and I'll fly in the sky so fancily. With my imagination, I'll be a big sensation, cause I'm a pretty birdie.
I think I hate being on the camera.
When I feel like I'm acting.
Let's start from the first question.
What is your name?
My name is Caitlin Elaine.
Can you tell me how you wrote your song, Fly?
Tracy Chapman, you love this one. Cutie.
I've probably loved music my whole life. I feel like music was just always around growing up, and my parents definitely influenced my music taste, but luckily they had really good taste in music. We listened to a lot of Fleetwood Mac and Tracy Chapman.
Okay.
You just have music around us all the time. In the morning, getting ready, just playing around. Like, the funnest thing to do with my family was just play, dance, and sing in my living room with my brother. And my mom would put our little VHS camcorder hooked up to the TV, and we just watch herself dance and sing all day. And then after that, she would just play it for us while she was like cooking dinner in the kitchen. So that was like our form of entertainment. I started writing songs probably when I was around 4, but I don't think I realized what I was doing. I think the first video recording that I can remember is me getting this porcelain doll for Christmas and holding it up, pretending it was like the American doll I wanted, and me singing a song about that.
Look for you everywhere.
I'm gonna wrap your presents tonight. I probably should do a couple tonight. I'll try to do two of them tonight.
Mama, you are so American. I love you, American girls.
Caitlin, you are a good singer. It wasn't anything I gave too much thought to. It just almost was like whatever I was thinking that day came out in a little song.
I'm pretty birdie without no wings, and I'll fly in the sky so fancily.
When I was younger, it sounds silly saying now, but my biggest dream was probably to fly, because I just really believed in it. I love Peter Pan. It was my favorite movie of all time.
Yep, watch me now. Here I go. It's easier than pie.
He can fly!
He can fly!
He flew!
I just wanted to go away to Neverland. I never wanted to grow up and be an adult, because that just sounded horrible.
Why will I never ever be a kid anymore?
When you're a grown up? Well, because we grow up. We're not Peter Pan. Only Peter Pan stays a kid forever and ever and ever.
I really believe that, like, Peter Pan would come to my window one day and take me, and I remember, like, going to my windowsill and looking out the window at night, being like, okay, tonight's the night, let's go, I'm ready. Take me to Neverland so I don't ever have to grow up, and I'll fly with you. I just remember that word and that idea being around me constantly. something that was like a theme going on when I was younger. I just always wanted to fly.
You gonna fly?
For me, going into sixth grade was probably the biggest transition of feeling like, oh, I'm a kid, I'm free, I get to play. I believe in this dream that I'll fly one day, to being, oh no, that doesn't exist. And now you have to start focusing on more serious things, like what you want to do when you grow up. And during that time of having already that hard transition of going from elementary school to middle school, on top of that, my nana passed away the summer going into sixth grade, and that was just such a change in my life. It was kind of like, at that moment, you're not a kid anymore, because I had experienced death before, but never really had like a super big grasp on it, because my grandfather had passed away when I was probably six, so I just didn't really understand it. But when my nana passed, it was just the hardest thing, because she was so special to me. Like, I can't talk about her without crying. I guess I didn't really so much I miss my nana.
This is Caitlin with Nana, the two birthday girls.
I get my name from her. Her name was Elaine, and so that's why my middle name is Elaine.
So Elaine, when are you gonna sing for us?
Not me.
You're not gonna sing for us?
No.
What? This is your party.
No. In my yesteryears.
I think the last time I had seen her was probably maybe the beginning of summer, and then she wasn't doing so well, and we just drove out to see her, and she passed right when we got off the freeway to the hospital. And I remember wanting to go and see her, even though she was gone. I just wanted to see her and give her the bracelet that I made her.
Please don't take my sunshine away.
I just loved her so, so much. I miss her all the time. I remember going to middle school felt like, oh, there's all these new people I don't know. And then some people who I did know from elementary school went there in fifth grade, and they had already made new friends. And so I remember the first day, like, waiting by the little lockers outside the door. I got there super early. I just felt like I couldn't talk to anybody, and these other people were talking to this other Caitlin, and I was like, I'm here, and I'm quiet and shy and in my head. And I guess that was just the summary of how I felt going into middle school. It was like, I don't have any friends. I did have like a couple people who I hung out with, but I felt like I couldn't really be myself around them because I didn't even know who that was. It just felt very abrupt from being a kid who plays and doesn't care what people think of them or what they look like and isn't very aware or self-conscious, to being the complete opposite of that, which is hyper aware, hypersensitive of what everyone might possibly be thinking about me. I felt like I would have to second guess everything I say when I'd start a conversation with someone. It was just like the worst fear for me. I guess I didn't realize how much social anxiety I had, but it was a really awful time. I hated middle school, especially sixth grade though. Sixth grade was the freaking worst. There was definitely this search of middle school. I think the hopeless feeling came from feeling like I didn't have a purpose. Like, I would compare myself a lot to all my cousins and be like, oh, you know, so-and-so does soccer and this person's taking piano and I'm just here not doing anything, and what am I even good at? I liked singing and I liked music, but back in the 90s or early 2000s, it was a lot of like Britney Spears or like performers, and I didn't feel like I fit into that at all. And so I didn't really know what I wanted to do until I went to this church camp, and that kind of changed everything for me. I remember going straight from science camp, meeting up at my church, getting in a van with all these kids that I didn't know that well. I think we had like a couple meetings before that, but it was just like a recipe for my social anxiety to be at a total peak. And I had my cousin Erin there with me, and I knew her, but she was older and she had cool friends, and I just felt like I was tagging along as this annoying, awkward, younger cousin. And I just remember being so self-conscious and nervous and afraid of the older kids, especially. Something about that just, I felt like I couldn't join in anything that they were saying, or if I spoke, like, they would make fun of me, they'd laugh at me, which probably wasn't the case, but in my head, I really, like, believed that. And it was this beautiful place, like, there were so many things to do, and I just remember the first day feeling really sad and kind of left out and not comfortable with my skin, not comfortable with the way I looked, and questioning a lot of things about myself, and just feeling very alone and isolated up there. I think we went to chapel twice a day, and there would be somebody speaking, and then there would be music played in between, and a big theme was asking God for help and knowing that you're not alone. It was kind of like the opposite of what I was feeling, which was very alone and very isolated. And so they kept repeating again, you know, if you need help, if you have questions about your life, like, God's there to give you that love and answer that. And I didn't believe it. So I remember kind of walking through the woods up there in this beautiful place and just saying, God, I feel like you didn't give me a purpose. I feel left out. I feel like everyone around me has something that they're good at, that they're supposed to do, that's gonna be their job, and I don't feel that. And so, God, if you are there, please give me a sign, show me what I'm supposed to do, because I just don't feel like you gave me anything to be good at, a purpose to make me feel special or just to make me feel like I'm not alone here. But it was a lot to feel at that age, but it's just the truth of it. I was just really searching for what my purpose was, because I had no idea. Immediately after the time I had prayed to the next time we had gone to chapel, this really amazing thing took place that changed the course of my entire life. It was almost like God heard how angry I was and how frustrated, and was like, I'm gonna give you the sign you've been longing for. The next time we went to chapel after I had prayed, the same band came up, and the band was called Moy after the lead singer. And he started telling this story about this song he wrote called Superman.
This next song is called Superman. I had a girl approach me a couple of months ago. And she said, you know that song, Superman, that's my song. You see, when I was 3 years old, my parents died. Since then, I've had 9 sets of foster parents. One right after the other. And every time I lose them, I feel so sad. But every time I get a new set of parents, I felt like that song. It says, because I want to fly like Superman does and feel tremendous. She's like, but then when I lose them, I feel like the bridge says, because what goes up must come down, and what's coming down is coming down fast. I think you fell on my heart. It broke into 1,000,000 pieces, and each piece into 1,000 creases, and every crease a memory in my heart that I wanted to fly like Superman and feel tremendous. Each and every one of us are unique, and we've got a story. You see, if she would have never shared her story with me, I would not be sharing it with you. And oh my, how much she thought maybe that it was insignificant. How are we to love the world if we don't share with the world? Share your story, share what God has done. Sometimes the very thing that's keeping us from sharing and being open is the one thing that God wants to use in our lives to reach a world that is lost. Superman.
It sounds crazy. I know it sounds crazy. I feel crazy saying it, but I heard a voice as I was listening to that song after I had heard that story, almost like a thought was taken that wasn't mine, which I feel like is coming from God, and it was like planted into my head. Basically what it said was, your purpose is to heal people from your music, and through that also heal yourself by making it. And that it almost was like this general summary of like, that is the real purpose of music, and that is where you will find your love and purpose for it. It was like, I asked and I was given the answer immediately, which nothing like that has ever really happened that quickly in my life. And it just felt like the most magical, amazing, loving force of energy ever. Up until that point, I didn't realize music could do that for people, that you could sing this song and have somebody come approach him and feel connected to that who went through something completely different. And then listening to that song, on top of that, he's talking about flying.
'Cause I wanted to fly.
And it was like reminding me that I can still do that. There's still a way to fly in a different way than I had thought when I was younger. It was like the universe telling me, like, don't give up on that dream that was there for a reason. The reason why you've always loved Peter Pan and flying, and that wasn't just meaningless make-believe, it was real. So after I'd been home, you know, I was on this high of like, I figured out what I want to do. And you think, oh, she would have just jumped in right then and started writing a million songs. And I didn't, because I couldn't. It was like I went from being on this high of like, yes, I know exactly what I want to do, to being like, oh fuck, I can't do any of that at all. Like, I just remember having this newfound excitement and then feeling very crushed when I went to my notebook trying to write out stuff. And then my perfectionism kicked in, and I just remember crumbling up a bunch of pieces of paper and like throwing it whenever something would come out. It was just near to impossible. So that felt like, you know, this gift of knowing what I wanted to do had been given to me, but it still felt like kind of an impossible thing, because everything that I would come up with never felt good enough for me. And I'd just be so hard on myself the whole time during that process, trying to write songs. It just never worked when there was that pressure of, you have to make something good that people will like. So going from middle school to high school, I guess I on and off was still trying to come up with different songs every once in a while, kind of like singing in my bathroom on my laptop, and nothing was ever like a solid thing. It wasn't until I experienced my first heartbreak that I wrote my first song.
I really miss him more than he knows.
I had all these bottled up emotions that I needed to go out somewhere. And so it was the first time where I wasn't sitting down saying, I'm gonna write a song. It was just like, I have more emotions than I can handle right now. I'm overflowing. I need to get it out in some way.
Watch me as I fall.
It was just a type of pain unlike any other I had experienced up until that point. And even till this day, I don't think there will be anything quite like the pain you feel from the heartbreak of a first love. Because that type of loss just imprints on your memory somehow, and it sticks with you forever, even after all the pain is gone.
Me.
Along with writing and verbalizing your feelings, helped you get through your heartbreak?
I don't know if it's a particular thing per se that helped me deal with that heartache at the time, but I would say the biggest influence and help through that time was definitely Taylor Swift.
And he says, our song is a slam a screen door, sneak an eye, tapping on your window.
I'm just so grateful to have had someone like her going through high school, because I honestly don't know what the heck I would have done if I didn't have like teardrops on my guitar and everything else that I used to listen to during that time that just helped me cope with the emotions, because she felt it and it was real and it was her real life experiences and everything she had gone through. She was almost like the example that I needed when I was younger in elementary school. Otherwise, I think I would have come to that conclusion before even going to church camp, but she was like really there for me, even though that sounds kind of cheesy. She like, I just love her till this day, but she really helped me through that time when it felt like I couldn't really talk to anyone about it.
How old are y'all? I'm going to Taylor Swift concert.
So then this really crazy magical thing happened again where I was home and my mom woke me up really early and I was really frustrated. But then she said, would you like to go to Taylor Swift concert? And I was like, what? She's like, yeah, you can go to a Taylor Swift concert for free, and someone's flight got canceled and they can't make it, so Kendall wants to know if you'll go with her. And I was like, oh yeah, of course.
Who's playing tonight?
Oh, Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift. That's who's playing, girl.
So before we even got to the concert, I was just getting ready and doing my hair and playing with the guitar a little bit, and this crazy thing happened where I wrote my song. I wrote my very first full song on this day, the same day I'm getting surprised with tickets to Taylor Swift's concert. And the only reason why I'm going is because my best friend's mom's friend was a flight attendant and this flight got canceled. And I'm just thinking, what are the chances of me not even supposed to go here? And then finding out that day, and then also having that same day be the day I write my first song. And it was just this really surreal thing, and getting to see someone I look up to so much as a singer-songwriter and have her talk about all the time she came home from school and she was just writing during school and after school, and it just felt like this moment was just a sign. Like it was this huge sign, this little part of the puzzle just to keep going with what was happening. It just, there was no explanation, no logical explanation that could make that magic moment make sense. And it was just crazy. And I still think about that all the time, just how magic that was. And it just feels like it's all meant to be in some way, just like a sign from the universe saying, you're on the right track, you're doing the right thing, keep going, and this could be you one day. It just kind of felt so surreal, magical, and yeah, I'm crying now even thinking about it. Just crazy.
Well, it's Taylor Swift tonight, Kendall.
It was amazing. It was a life-changing experience.
I'll see you when I'm famous and I'm on stage.
This is a song I wrote, but I'm going to turn off the lights in the house because I'm making an annoying noise. But yes, this is the song I wrote, and I'm going to play it right now. It's called Fly. Okay.
So I shared that video my junior year of high school. And then during and after high school, I tried recording the song. I've gone to 3 different studios to try and get it done, and it just never felt good enough. And I think a lot of that has to do with my perfectionism kicking in, that feeling inside that nothing will ever be good enough. And I feel like I was just being really hard on myself with how I share it. And it was almost like I was forcing myself so much to believe that it had to come out that way. And now that I'm looking at the story of everything and everything else that's happened along the way, nothing has ever been perfect. Like sharing it in the past was never the way I wanted, with the quality of the video and the audio and everything that I thought people would pick apart. You know, I just, when I had the courage to and I just shared it, magical things happened. But then that fear kicks in of like, oh, what if I put all this work into, you know, making a video, sharing the story, and then nothing happens, nothing comes of it. When I start to feel that way, I go back to everything that Moy had said and that girl who came up to him. Look how much her sharing that story affected me, and I don't even know who that girl is. She has no idea that by her being vulnerable and her sharing her story with him and him sharing it with everyone in the audience and me hearing it, that completely changed the course of my life. Like, because of that, I know what I want to do. So I'm like in this position where I've been holding on to this and I'm afraid to share it because I want things to be perfect and I know they're never gonna be that way. And so I've been trying to let go of that more and more. And I feel like I just want to be brave, but I'm still scared and I'm moving through the fear of it. But when I look back at everything I've gone through and all the signs along the way and everything that's like lined up and these videos of me singing about how I want to be a pretty birdie, how I want to fly, and even when I'm a little baby, I'm like singing with my mom, with everything that happened at the church camp and the Taylor Swift thing and writing a song on September 1st, which happens to be my pop-pop's birthday, and he just passed like May or June.
Here's Caitlin and pop-pop. How's that?
I feel like that all wasn't just coincidence and that all wasn't just the universe being like, ha ha ha, joke's on you. Like, this all isn't a sign. It's just some like random happenstance. I don't believe that at all. I feel like they've all been little signs along the way for a reason. And as much as I'm scared, and I think I'll always be scared of the unknown, I just want to jump into it so that I can get to the other side of it. The scariest part is just feeling like nothing will come of it. But I've gone to the point where the fear of regret is stronger than just jumping in and trying it and failing. And so that's kind of where it's gone to now. And I feel like maybe I was just supposed to release the whole song and everything with the story because, you know, going back to Moy, it's like if he hadn't shared that girl's story, that song would have touched me, but it wouldn't have had the same experience on my heart and completely shifted the trajectory of where I am today. And he said something in the speech like, share your story, share what you're going through. Like, how are we to love the world if we don't share with the world? And I truly believe that, like, being vulnerable is like your biggest superpower. Like, that makes you Superman and that makes you able to fly when you, like, you put yourself out there and you're just like your true authentic self as much as you can be, as scary as that is. Like, you also get like the most powerful and like loving feeling from that. And so at this point, I just like want to hug that little version of myself and be like, I know that you're scared and you're a perfectionist and nothing's ever good enough, but I feel that way. And we're letting go of that harshness with ourselves, and we're just letting what we make breathe and what we make, we're letting that go into the world and we're letting that become whatever it's supposed to. And that's where I'm at this point. And I just feel like, if anything, this is just a good way for me to remember everything that's happened, because I don't want to forget all the little magical steps along the way. I want to remember all of that and know that it's all happening for a reason. I just don't know what or where or how, but I just feel like I'm supposed to share it. And so I feel like that's the right thing to do.
My name's Caitlin Elaine. This is my song, Fly. I'm nervous, but I'm gonna do it anyways.
Cause that's what life's about.
Okay. Take back every kiss. Leave me nothing more to miss. And I won't cry. Cause I can fly.
Oh yeah, I want to make another collage because I made this one. These are like mainly all the musicians that like have inspired me. There's like Regina Spektor, Lights, Taylor Swift, Johnny Cash. I love Johnny Cash. This is like my favorite picture too. One right here.
Yeah.
And then Moy. Not a lot of people know about Moy, but it was cool, the whole story about him. But he really inspires me. And then just a bunch of their different lyrics. I wanted to fly like Superman does and feel tremendous. 'Cause what goes.
Hey, Elaine, I was gonna go around to everybody and ask them what their name was and if they had anything to say to you, but I figured that'd be too cheesy. So, do you have anything to say to yourself?
GM good.
All right.
Yeah, I'm a treasure.